Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Morrow Gospel Church here in Winnipeg, Manitoba. My name is Lil Gertson, and I'm so glad that I'm able to be here with you this morning and to help lead in worship. Yesterday and today have been a welcome change in the weather, and I'm not here to give you a weather report, so don't worry. But it's just been fun watching how the birds have been much more active at the bird feeders, and we've been watching rabbits running up and down our driveways, and you've probably seen them running around in your yards too. We get deer wandering through our neighborhood. I don't know how many of you do that or see that, but we live fairly close to the river, and there's lots of houses around our place, but we have deer in our neighborhood, so that's been an interesting observation, just watching how they have made themselves very much at home in our yard as well as our neighbor's yard. They've actually made little nests underneath the tree, and so you can see where these big hollows are under the tree and where the bird or where the deer have been hiding out. Creation all around us seems to be waking up, and maybe I'm a little bit early for this, but we're looking forward to spring. At least I'm looking forward to spring. It's a good distraction from all of the pain and the difficulties that we see all around us. And it's a good reminder that God looks after absolutely everything. He sees the birds. He knows where the grass is underneath all that snow. And he even knows every single hair on each one of our heads. Some of us, it'll be pretty easy for him to count, and others, not so much. But he knows the details of our lives. And isn't that pretty amazing that we serve a God who knows everything about us, and he listens to us, and he hears us. This Wednesday, I just want to remind you that it's the start of Lent, and that's our journey towards Easter. So some of you will probably be watching some things or reading devotionals that will help us focus more on Lent. And so it's just a reminder, and if you're looking for some resources, I can certainly connect you with some, or there's some very good ones online. So if you want to find resources that will just help you be a little bit more focused on the journey towards Easter, I encourage you to do that. Just a note for the older kids for Sunday school, there will be no Sunday school this morning for the older children, so when the message comes up, just remember the older ones get to stay here with us. Let's join our hearts in prayer. God of hope, we come into your presence this morning with confidence that you will meet us here. Where there is sadness, we ask that you replace it with joy. Where there is tiredness, bring refreshment. And where there is despair, bring a renewed sense of hope. Let this be a sanctuary, a safe haven for us, and a home for our holy words and songs and prayers as we commit ourselves to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning. I invite you to stand as we continue singing together with Glorious Day.
Could be. Sorry about that. Okay, our scripture reading from this morning comes from Exodus chapter 34, verses 29 to 35. When Moses came down Mount Sinai carrying the two stone tablets inscribed with the terms of the covenant, he wasn't aware that his face had become radiant because he had spoken with the Lord. So when Aaron and the people of Israel saw the radiance of Moses' face, they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called out to them and asked Aaron and all the leaders of the community to come over, and he talked with them. Then all the people of Israel approached him, and Moses gave them all the instructions the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. When Moses finished speaking with them, he covered his face with a veil. But whenever he went to the tent of meeting to speak with the Lord, he would remove the veil until he would come out again. Then he would give the people whatever instructions the Lord had given him. And the people of Israel would see the radiant glow of his face. So he would put the veil over his face until he returned to speak with the Lord.
Thank you, Katie, and your helpers. It's always good to have our children and grandchildren join us when we are leading worship. They are certainly part of what happens here at Morrow Gospel, so it's good to have them involved as well. Just a reminder that we're having communion next Sunday morning, so for those of you who would like to pick up communion pieces here at the church, you're welcome to do so, or just a reminder to prepare your elements for at home for next Sunday. Our prayers of the people this morning are going to concentrate on the things that are happening in Ukraine. You'll notice in the bulletin there's some other things that are noted, and so I encourage you to pray for those items on your own. But this morning, let's join in our heart, or let's join our hearts as we pray for Ukraine. Just a bit of an introduction here. Hundreds of thousands of German-speaking Mennonites once lived in Ukraine. Nearly all migrated or were forcibly removed during political upheavals of the late 19th and 20th centuries. And some of us here in the congregation are descendants of those immigrants. Today, there are several Mennonite congregations still in Ukraine. As many of you know, this past Thursday, Russian soldiers invaded Ukraine, and we've seen images and heard audio on TV and our devices of cities and communities being bombed and people seeking shelter or looking for ways to leave Ukraine. Most of us here have no firsthand experience of the horrors of war. We can only imagine and put ourselves into those situations. Our hearts break and we grieve as we watch from a great distance. But we can stand in prayer with our community and with our Ukrainian brothers and sisters. Let's join together. Our sovereign and holy God, we pray to you when hope is scarce. People around the world are saddened and pained that the people of Ukraine must live with the fear and destruction of war. You alone know the extent of the crimes committed in Ukraine and the people murdered, the homes and infrastructure destroyed. Father, raise up peacemakers. Give the world leaders wisdom as they impose sanctions, looking for diplomatic and economic ways to end this aggression. Raise up resistance to war in Russia itself. Protect the people of Ukraine who are reeling from the trauma of invasion. Open the arms of neighboring countries to take in refugees. In times like these, fill us with resolve rather than hatred. Father, we pray that peace can be found even in the roar and rubble of war. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, amen.
Thank you. I invite you to join us as we sing together with Sanctuary. We're going to stand as we sing together.
Sanctuary, pure and holy.
seated.
Our reading from Luke chapter 9, verses 28 to 43. Luke chapter 9, verses 28 to 43. About 8 days later, Jesus took Peter, John, and James up on a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face was transformed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared and began talking with Jesus. They were glorious to see, and they were speaking about his exodus from this world, which was about to be fulfilled in Jerusalem. Peter and the others had fallen asleep. When they woke up, they saw Jesus' glory and the two men standing with him. As Moses and Elijah were starting to leave, Peter, not even knowing what he was saying, blurted out, "Master, it's wonderful for us to be here. Let's make three shelters as memorials, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." But even as he was saying this, a cloud overshadowed them, and terror gripped them as the cloud covered them. Then a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." When the voice was finished, Jesus was there alone. They didn't tell anyone at that time what they had seen. The next day, after they had come down the mountain, a large crowd met Jesus. A man in the crowd called out to him, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son, my only child. An evil spirit keeps seizing him, making him scream. It throws him into convulsions so that he foams at the mouth. It batters him and hardly ever leaves him alone. I begged your disciples to cast out the spirit, but they couldn't do it." Jesus said, "You faithless and corrupt people, how long must I be with you and put up with you?" Then he said to the man, "Bring your son to me." As the boy came forward, the demon knocked him to the ground and threw him into a violent convulsion. But Jesus rebuked the evil spirit and healed the boy. Then he gave the son back to his father. Awe gripped the people as they saw this majestic display of God's power.
Let us pray. Our great God, it is a joy and a privilege to gather, whether at home by our screens or here in person, but to gather in your presence. And Father, we desire to experience your glory. Would you shine on us? Would you reveal yourself, your holiness, your glory, your truth to us this morning, so that we might accurately see and then reflect what we have seen. In the name of Christ, amen. Can you folks hear me okay? No? Okay, I'll try to speak up super loud this morning and see if that works for us. Is that better? And I think I'm on here, so we'll trust the guys at the back to be able to adjust. Let me bring us to our passage and transition to our passage that was read by this. When certain things are arranged in a certain way, it triggers a memory, whether it be notes or words. Some things happen in a certain order, and we grow in anticipation or dread. As children on Saturday mornings, if we were in the next room and all of a sudden we would hear from the living room, "On with the show, this is it." Yep, those of you that are older remember. We knew that it was time for Bugs Bunny and the Roadrunner Hour. If we're watching an adventure movie, a thriller, the music becomes more dramatic, our muscles tighten, and we know that something is going to start happening, something big. In the account that was read for us this morning, there are a number of triggers, and these triggers are of great significance, but easily missed by us because of our limited knowledge of the early century Jewish experience or their memory. So for the people in the Jewish community in the early century, when they read this text, there would have been many trigger points. Just like that little tune from Bugs Bunny for some of us older ones. I'd like us to look at that a little bit through a Jewish eye and experience this morning. This text from Luke chapter 9. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all contain the accounts of the transfiguration. And when we use that word transfiguration, we're just saying a change in form or appearance. That's what that word means. A change in form or appearance. We find this account of this change in Jesus' outlook or the way that he looked in Matthew chapter 19, in Mark 9, and here in Luke what was read. There's some variation in what is included about this event in these three different Gospels. They're very similar, but some include a little bit more or some a little bit less. But the way that the event is placed in all of these three Gospels is the same. This is what I mean by that. The way that the event is placed, framed, the larger context of the event is the same in all three Gospels. It takes place after a period of traveling throughout the region when Jesus has been teaching in the synagogues, performing many miracles, and much of it has been a disclosure of his identity, a pulling back of the veil. And now he huddles with the disciples and he asks them what they understood so far. That's in Luke chapter 9, verse 18. One day Jesus left the crowds to pray alone. Only his disciples were with him. And he asked them, "Who do people say that I am?" And then people give various things that they're hearing about people trying to figure out who is this Jesus. And that's when Peter makes this bold claim, this proclamation about Jesus' identity. Peter replied, "You are the Messiah sent from God, the Anointed One. You are the Christ." And then right after that, Jesus warned them. Jesus warned the disciples not to tell anyone that he is the Son of Man because the Son of Man must suffer many things. And then Jesus goes on to predict his death that was coming when he traveled to Jerusalem. So we have this proclamation, this confession of who he is, and then this prediction of his death. And then in all three Gospels, it is followed by this fuller reveal on the mountain. That was the extreme revelation of Jesus' identity. There had been glimmers of it throughout this time, confessions and... But here on the mountain with these three disciples, you get the full reveal. Try helping us understand what that was really like. I was thinking about some of the super heroes of the past, the TV shows. Was that Mr. Kent would take off his glasses, and is it he that would go in the phone booth and all of a sudden he'd emerge as this superhero? Spider-Man, Wonder Woman. They all had these times when all of a sudden they would change from what we thought they were to what they were in this other world or realm. And that's a little bit what we get here on this mountain, this Mount of Transfiguration. A full reveal, or at least much fuller than what the disciples had seen up to this point. And some of it is quite obvious to us. The change in his face, his appearance, his clothes all of a sudden glowing, and then that booming voice from the cloud. "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." And for many of us, that's what sticks out, because that in itself would be pretty amazing. You wouldn't forget that right away. A guy's face all of a sudden being transformed, looking very different and glowing, and this voice from a cloud. Those are the obvious ones, but there are some that, as I said before, are not quite as obvious to us. But to these Jewish men, they would have been huge trigger points. One of them was just this idea of going up to the mountain to pray. Somebody has said that when God does big things, especially in the Old Testament, it's always up on the mountain. That would have been one. But there are similarities between this experience and Moses' experience on Mount Sinai. The cloud. We read lots about that in the Exodus and on the mountain. And even a voice from the cloud. If you've been reading the texts that are in our bulletin, you will have noticed in Psalm 99 a reflection of how God spoke and led the people in Psalm 99, and he spoke to us from the cloud. So they had this experience of a cloud and a voice. It would have triggered something. The appearance of Moses' face changing. Exodus 31, 29, and I'll quickly read part of that for us again. Exodus 34, verse 29. "Then Moses came down Mount Sinai, carrying the two stone tablets inscribed, which inscribed the terms of the covenant." That was the older covenant. "He wasn't aware that his face had become radiant." Now listen to this. "He wasn't aware that his face had become radiant because he had spoken to the Lord." He wasn't aware that his face had become radiant because, cause and effect here, his face had become radiant because he had spoken to the Lord. And then the story goes on, their account in Exodus goes on, that the glow would fade, but then when he would go back in communion with God, speaking with God, then it would again be glowing. And we have that whole story of the veil. But there was something that was happening with Moses when he was in this intimate fellowship with God, speaking to God as one face to face, and it would change the way that Moses' face appeared to the people. And now Jesus is up on the mountain in prayer. While he was praying, his face changed, transfigured. It looked different to them. That's would have been a huge for these three guys. And then the other thing that I found unique is that in the Exodus story, where Moses comes down with these two tablets, down from Mount Sinai, excited about what he's going to be telling the people, and what does he encounter when he comes to the bottom of the mountain? Are people just eager to hear what God has told him? What does he find? A people that have given in to disbelief, that have accepted a lie, that are now worshiping a golden calf. And behaving badly. This story that we find here, this mountain experience, when Jesus and the three come down, all three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the next account is about what they experience at the bottom of the mountain. And it seems to be around unbelief again. And the phrase that Jesus says there, it sounded so severe, so disappointed in what he finds. Oh, you unbelieving generation, how long must I put up with you? I was going to base my whole sermon just around that. Jesus has stern words. I didn't, because I thought there was something more important. But I want to draw that all of this is the same in all three of the Gospels. The confession, the prediction of the death, the crucifixion, then this incredible experience up on the mountain, and then coming down the mountain and the account of the boy that has a severe oppression or demonic thing happening to him. We couldn't do this. Some of the Gospels say, your disciples let us down. And Jesus saying, how long? Disappointed in their lack of faith. And then all three of the Gospels, the next thing is again a prediction about what is coming in Jerusalem, his death. And so that's very significant, it seems to me. The other part that is significant is the two people that are joined, that are all of a sudden appearing with Jesus on the mountain. The disciples have fallen asleep, as some of you do when I preach. I don't blame you. They have fallen asleep. All of a sudden they wake up and they see Jesus, and they see that Jesus has company. It's not just the four of them anymore. There's two other guys with Jesus. Now for us, it's Moses and Elijah. But Moses and Elijah, that is very significant for a Jewish person. George Dirksen, if he was here, I was going to ask him. He probably is here. He is back there. One of George's favorite verses is from Matthew chapter 7. Do unto others what you would have them do unto you. And then what does it say? For the whole law and the prophets hang on these two things. Are summed up in this. Do unto others what you would have them do to you. This is the essence of all that is taught in the law and the prophets. The two pillars of the Jewish faith are the law of Moses and the prophets, the word of the prophets. That's what the Jewish faith rests on. And who appears on this mountain with Jesus? The law of Moses. The law came through Moses. It was equated with Moses. Moses is there. And who is Elijah? Well, Elijah was the prophet of prophets. When you thought of a prophet, and the greatest prophet, you thought about Elijah. For those of you that are hockey fans, it was like when you think of hockey, at least my generation, who do you think of? Wayne Gretzky. Absolutely. And when you think, Paul, don't say, when you think of basketball, who do you think of? Many of us. Michael Jordan. That's who appeared on the mountain. Not these two guys, but for the Jewish, it was the big of the big showed up with Jesus. The law and the prophets there together with Jesus. This was huge. You couldn't get bigger. That's what they woke up to. It was very, very significant. This was authority. The three, Moses, the chief of the law, Elijah, the chief of the prophets, and Jesus. And then comes, first comes Peter's blurting out, hey, this is good. Let me set up three tents. The text is right. He probably didn't know what he was saying, but he was overwhelmed with this honored spot. What would they have done with those three? It was just a way of saying, let's capture this. Let's not lose this moment. Let's set up a memorial. How will people believe us if we don't do something? He wanted to stay in there to capture that. It was so precious. But right after that, or in the midst of that, then all of a sudden, the cloud. And then what happens with the cloud? A voice. And then what happens when the voice is gone? Read the text. There's only Jesus. The other two are gone. The law and the prophets find their fulfillment in Jesus. This is my son. Listen to him. These other things, these other people, they are all pointing to him. But this is now the supreme. This is the revelation. This is the truth. Listen to him. That was God underlining. This is what I am doing. This is what is now your authority. The fulfillment of all that has come up to this point. Listen to him. It was huge. And why in this context? Going back to that bigger thing. Why this huge event, sandwiched in the midst of what I've already said, all the Gospels have done? I think this is why. God, in his grace, confirms what they were coming to believe about Jesus. He does it because this clear unveiling will be crucial for where their journey with Jesus will soon take them. This fuller revelation, this underlining, this highlighting of Jesus' true identity was important because of what would soon take place. Let me say again, because once they had this incredible sense, this is the Christ. We're not just guessing anymore. Like, this is as clear as it can get, that this is the chosen one, the anointed one. Once they were so convinced of that, there was trouble, or possible trouble. All of those dreams that they had of knocking off that Roman government, of establishing the kingdom of Jerusalem, the Jewish kingdom again, all of that would start bubbling. But that's not what this was about. This was the Messiah. But it was the suffering Messiah. It was the Messiah that would give his life so that there would be true victory and true peace, more than the political things that they were dreaming of at that point. And I think that is why it is so intentionally sandwiched between all of these other events. As the unveiling was being turned up, Jesus' true identity was becoming clearer. The message of the cross is also being turned up. I was thinking about the equalizers or different things, you know, where this goes up and then it's important for this goes up as well. And that's what you have here. A true revelation, an unveiling of Jesus. And with that is also this message of the cross. Because those two would have to go together as they march towards Jerusalem. In grace, he is preparing them, giving them something to hang on to when all hell would break loose. And I wonder about that for us. When we misplace our dreams on things that we can see in this life rather than on those eternal things that really matter. When we think that it's more about our happiness and our comfort than what really matters is our transformation and our changing into the kind of people that God wants us to be. We're just getting out of COVID. In that one song, I was going to start singing, "What a glorious day, March 15th, no more masks we have to wear. March 15, we have new freedom." It's going to be a glorious getting out of this on the other side of all this. But that's stuff that we can imagine because we've experienced that kind of glory before. But what will true glory be? When there are not limitations or fears of COVID or those kind of things, but when there's no longer fear of death. All those bigger fears, the things that are worth being scared of, when we've experienced that victory, how glorious will that be? And our little minds and our distractions, we forget that. But that is what I want to plant in our minds and our imagination now as we move towards Easter, as we enter the Lenten season, to allow God to take us up a mountain, intentional prayer and in presence with God so that we can get a bigger and a fresh image, a vision of glory. And that glory, the future and the true glory, the true reality that we will, those of us who are in Christ, will one day experience that true reality, that might motivate us to come back down the mountain with radiant faces. With faces of hope and a message of hope to a world that is desperate and dying. And that leads me to my finish. I'm way off track in my notes and it's time to land the plane, but here we are. What I've tried to say this morning is what was happening there was almost God very intentionally saying, that was then, this is now. And then the Apostle Paul takes it in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 to saying, and this, my brothers and sisters, is now. And I think that Paul would have had a little bit of, what do you call that when people have a certain walk? You know, a strut. Yes, that's it. Thank you. I wasn't even going to use that word. But yeah, I think that Paul had a little bit of that when he was writing this. Listen. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 7. The old way, with laws etched in stone, led to death. Though it began with such glory that the people of Israel could not bear to look at Moses' face. For his face shone with the glory of God, even though the brightness was already fading away. So Paul says that was then, Moses and the law. And it was glorious. Yeah, it was. But shouldn't we expect a far greater glory under the new way? Now, the Holy Spirit is giving life. If the old way, which brings condemnation, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new way, which makes us right with God? This new way that makes us right with God. In fact, that first glory was not glorious at all compared with the overwhelming glory of the new way. The new way of Christ. So if the old way, which has been replaced, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new, which remains forever? Now verse 12, this is where the strutting happens. Since the new way gives us such confidence, we can be very bold. We are not like Moses, who put the veil over his face so that the people of Israel will not see his glory, even though it was destined to fade away. But the people's minds were hardened. It was the old covenant. They could not understand the truth. And this veil can be removed only by the living Christ. Yes, even today, when they read Moses' writing, their hearts are covered with a veil and they do not yet understand. Verse 16. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is Spirit, and wherever the Spirit is, there is freedom. So all of us, listen now, so all of us who've had the veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is Spirit, makes us more and more like him, and we are changed into his glorious image. So all who've had the veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And that is where I want to land us today. All of us who have the veil removed because of Christ's death and resurrection can see the Lord and reflect his glory. So that leads us to a prayer and a couple of questions. Has the veil been removed? Has the veil of unbelief been removed from your eyes and the eyes of your heart? If not, this would be a good season to have the veil removed, to see Christ for who he is, and to experience the forgiveness, the removal of shame and guilt, and be drawn into the fellowship with the Father. This would be a good time to experience sight. Some of us know about cataracts. That's when a haze grows over the pupil and things are not as clear anymore. And some of you have had the cataracts removed. I live with a person that had that experience. And I'll never forget my first ride in the car with her. I was still driving. It was safer. I was going to say still is safer. No, Arlene is a terrific driver. I was driving and Arlene was with me on the day after, I think it was, that she had her cataracts removed. Same day. We're driving down St. Anne's, St. Mary's into downtown. And she was reading me all the signs, terrible advertising signs and, you know, all this junk that you see when you're driving down the roads. but she was reading all of them to me with such great excitement. She could see. The veil had been removed. Maybe through this pandemic, through seasons of great difficulty, it has been easy for unbelief to creep up into our hearts, to cloud our thinking, to cloud our vision. I think this Lenten season is a great time for us to think about what we're able to see or not see, to spend a little bit more time in God's presence, humbly and prayerfully asking Him to help us again see with faith the true reality of Jesus and our future glory with Him. Colossians chapter 3, verse 4, I think it is. When Christ appears, we will appear with Him in glory, yes, but we'll also appear with Him glorious. As we one day will see Jesus face to face in perfect fellowship and communion with our Father, with the Son, and the Holy Spirit, when all of that is the way that it was on the mountain, we will also shine in all of our glory. We will appear glorious. But we can already get foretastes of that. And those foretastes do not come just being stuck to our television screens or our phone screens. There's a glow that comes with that, but it's not always a healthy glow. But the glow that comes into our hearts and that begins radiating from our faces is something that only happens as we spend time in the presence of true reality. And so, my brothers and sisters, are we willing to go up the mountain to meet with our Lord? To experience reality and to then be able to reflect that glorious reality as we come down the mountain and as we deal with the disappointments until finally all will be made right. Amen.
Thank you. brothers and sisters, here is your benediction. I'll turn this on just in case.
May God give you grace never to sell yourself short. Grace to risk something big for something good and great. Grace to remember that the world is too dangerous for anything but truth, and too small for anything but love. And that the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Let us go to spend time on the mountain, to see the glory, and then to reflect the glory to all that we meet this week. Amen. Go in peace.